Welcome to the third episode of VYAP's growth series, where we try to instill hope and see the growth opportunities by speaking to industry experts. Our growth series is particularly aimed at sharing a message that every change comes along with a lot of hidden opportunities, and we can cash upon these opportunities by showcasing resilience, agility, and adaptability. On this occasion, we have with us Mr. Suhail Sameer, XMD of RPSG Ventures. Suhail, with around 2 decades of experience, has been instrumental in driving growth and portfolio decisions across businesses. Welcome, Suhail.
Thanks, Pankaj, and thanks, Vyap, for doing this. Very exciting to be here.
Okay, so Suhail, I have our first curiosity, so I'm going to start with my first curiosity. So how do you see the growth of FMCG segment in India? And what are the effects of the current pandemic in the functioning of the sector?
So I think FMCG sort of, in a way, was at least a large part of it. Staples and essentials were sort of spared the brunt of the COVID in a way. So I think many companies have continued to do well, whether it is in staples, whether it is in home care, whether it is in personal hygiene. But I think and sort of as we are coming out of COVID, and I'm like talking to a few of my colleagues from the industry, I think businesses are sort of getting back to their pre-COVID levels at a minimum. Of course, there are still some challenges, especially in containment areas around supply, distribution. But I think, hopefully a matter of a couple of weeks and these will also get sorted, right? So at least demand is sort of back. I think only time will tell whether this is like sort of sustained demand or this is just panic buying at the end of like 60, 70 days of lockdown. But I think as an industry, we're sort of hopeful that the business will be sort of back to usual from next one. I think the other part of what you said, which is where a lot more changes are happening on what happens post COVID and how does demand shift, right? So I think in general, the way I see COVID play out, and this is sort of collaborated with by some of my colleagues, is there are a few categories which will sort of get a lot more limelight, right? So I think generally people are very enthused about health and immunity right now, because you've all seen like impact of COVID, especially when you have a weak immune system and all of that. I think a lot of businesses which are sort of in the space of health and immunity, for example, like businesses like Dabur, Patanjali, businesses like Vaidyanath, and obviously a lot of new age companies in this space, which sort of have a big tailwind their way, where if they are able to meet the consumer demand on sort of matching their immunity requirements, I think there is a lot of demand to be had on that side. I think the second category which will see a lot more disruption is your core staples, right? So I think staples for us has always been atta, dal, chawal, and we've not sort of looked beyond that, even though a lot of the sort of what we call now fringe grains, like everything from ragi, johar and all of that, they're sort of all Indian grains, right? And they've been sort of part and parcel of our food over many centuries. I think a lot of that will sort of make a significant comeback, right? A lot more focus around balanced diet, a lot more eating at home, so therefore people experimenting with different grains and all of that. So I think staples will sort of also have two types of shifts. One is a lot of more focus on these alternate grains, as we talk, or organic or naturophonic and hydroponic type technologies, but also a lot of shift from unorganized, unbranded to branded, right? Where safety and quality sort of becomes paramount, right? So I think, at least on the food side, I see these big two shifts. I think similarly, I think a lot will happen on the home hygiene side, right? Home and personal care hygiene. Again, it is everyone washes their house, but if you look at branded penetration in households, it's still mediocre at best in India, right? So I think, you've seen what has happened to hand sanitizers during COVID. I think it will sort of start getting replicated into a lot more categories which are into the home and personal hygiene point of view, right? So I think these sort of essentials and better for you products, I think will have a very good runway for the next couple of years. I think some of the more luxury items, some of the more non-essential items may see a bit of a decline, but I think they anyway sort of catered to like top 10-15% of the Indian consumer class, and I think they will sort of anyway be buying them, right? So I don't think luxury companies will be overtly worried, but I think I see a lot of spike in health hygiene and both personal hygiene and home hygiene coming in out of home.
Okay. So I mean that's really optimistic even for smaller players. In fact, my second curiosity comes from the first curiosity itself. You know, so do you also see smaller players making a difference in this segment? Any significant difference by smaller players?
It is tough to say. I think if you look at historically, whenever such big disruptions have happened, bigger players have got bigger and smaller players have sort of struggled, right? Historically. I think it is primarily, at least in the FMCG industry, being driven by that distribution has been always the most important currency you have, right? And distribution has always stayed with large companies. Their ability to manage supply chain disruptions, distribution disruptions have always been better than everyone else. Therefore, they've sort of come out of such disruptions fastest, and which is probably reflective in, for example, how Britannia has taken this as an opportunity to grow. Having said that, I think two things which are different at this point of time than probably previous such disruptions. One is, I think distribution is no longer such a big moat as it used to be like 10-15 years back, right? So a lot of brands which are using online channels, which are using alternate channels like institutional sales, which are using like social commerce, which are using your own direct-to-consumer website based sales, I think many of those businesses have sort of done incredibly well, right? And e-commerce was anyway picking up in India, but sort of this COVID has sort of fast-tracked that, right? And if I take examples, even at my home, my parents would never be using a e-commerce website before, but now I see them ordering every day on Big Basket or Amazon or wherever, right? So I think generally the e-com penetration and people's comfort in ordering and paying online has sort of increased drastically, right? So if there are brands which sort of take advantage of that, right, and focus a lot more on institutional, focus a lot more on e-commerce, I think they will do really well. The second sort of brands which will sort of do well are brands which are offering something unique in terms of products, right? This is always true, but becomes even more true in today's context. So I can imagine a modern Ayurveda brand offering food products to boost immunity, sort of taking someone like a Dabur, if not head on, at least taking meaningful share away from it, done well, right? So I think there will be some sub-segments which will go through disproportionate growth, and companies, small companies, young companies, which are sort of at the cusp of that growth opportunity will sort of do well. And I think the third type of companies which will do well are companies which will offer value to consumers, right? So we've all heard of like salary cuts, we've all heard of potentially lesser disposable income. And even if it is not less disposable income, people who don't have a lot of money at hand, even if they have a secure job right now, they're not sure whether they will have one 6 months down the line, right? So a lot of consumption will, especially at the middle and the bottom of end of the pyramid, will sort of move towards more value for money purchases. Especially if you take categories like biscuits, snacks, soap, shampoo, you can do only that much wrong with those type of products. They are not earth-shattering products in terms of what they offer to a consumer. So I think there a lot of value players, regional players potentially have an opportunity to disrupt, right? So I think these three opportunities aside, I think big players will sort of also use this as an opportunity to really double down on distribution and do well, right? So I think if you are a young company, I think you have to figure out, are you either such value for money that you will fly, or are you offering a product which is going through a lot of tailwind demand, or are you doing something different in distribution where you can actually compete with the likes of a HUL or a Britannia? Because if you are trying to do the same distribution method as they are doing, that's going to be tough to execute.
Okay. So So you mean to say that money has become more costly now? In order to extract money from the consumer, the companies has to work really very hard.
Either you offer a product which is like disproportionately better, or you offer value which is disproportionately better, right? Or you offer a go-to-market like, boss, you don't have to move out of your home and everything will come to you. The convenience which is disproportionately better, especially in the context of people want to avoid stepping out of their homes, right? So if you are not able to solve for one of these three at a minimum, I think it is going to be challenging for anyone.
Okay, that's something, you know, which companies must be knowing it and they must be doing it, and in fact they must be feeling the heat as well, because one is COVID, the other is, you know, even these companies are managing their liquidity. At the same time, they have to give more value to the customer. So it's a lot of things, even for the companies also, it's becoming very challenging. So my third curiosity comes from the first and the second one itself, because when we started doing our growth series, we were always talking about the kind of opportunity it's going to bring to the humans. Because when you talk about technology, you know, it's like, you know, we with 138 crore people, we always know when you talk about technology, people have a fear that, okay, technology means losing jobs. Over the time, you know, this is subsiding, this kind of thought process is subsiding. But, you know, would like to understand from you, what are the employment prospects, both direct and indirect, in this segment? And do you see this sector getting more organized, or is there a significant scope of even unorganized segment? I think some of it, which you have already answered, doing business in this sector.
So I think FMCG as a category is always going to be a mix of organized and unorganized. Unorganized is generally very convenient. Your next door shop, your next door chakki, especially in like food categories. And it typically always has a pricing advantage, right? Because of differential taxes and all of that. So especially a lot of value consumers in this context may actually move a lot more towards unorganized. And at least the initial data I'm seeing is you don't get a lot of unorganized data, but I am seeing a bit of data on people going to more value brands, right? So people who are probably buying and I'm using it as an example, it's not the data I'm sharing, but people who are buying a 20 rupee chips pack are probably buying a 10 rupee chips pack, and 10 rupee guy is moving to a 5 rupee chips pack. A 5 rupee guy who was buying a 5 rupee branded chips pack is probably buying a 5 rupee unbranded, unorganized chips pack, right? So everyone is sort of, like at least a large part of the population is sort of trying to get more out of the single market, right? So I think, therefore, at least for foreseeable future, unorganized is likely to exist. And I don't personally believe that it's a bad thing, right? It keeps the market in check. It creates a lot of jobs. It creates a lot of entrepreneurship opportunities. I think the only thing which the government has to sort of maintain is like quality standards and hygiene standards and put some protocols around it. And sort of not make it too unfair for the organized guys, right? Because I've always had these debates on why should a Ashirwad Atta pay like 5% GST, whereas an unorganized player does not, right? So, and that just makes economics very bad for an organized player who anyways has extra cost of branding, etc., right? So, I think, again, I am not the right person to have an opinion on what should be the GST, but I think as long as there is meaningful competition and you let both of these streams to figure it out on their own and offer their value to consumers and let the consumer choose, it's fine. But overall, I believe, I think unorganized sort of will continue to work and will continue to thrive, at least in the short to medium term. I think in terms of job opportunities, I think it is already one of the largest job creation hubs for the country, right, as FMCG, as an industry. And I don't see that necessarily changing. I think demand has sort of not fallen as much, and therefore probably it's also one of the industries which has seen the least retrenchment, at least so far. And I think given the way the demand is shaping, I also don't expect a large job cuts at a minimum. I don't expect too much of that to happen, and I'm like at least seeing it in a few companies very closely, and everyone is sort of comfortable at the level they are operating. Profits have taken a bit of a tumble because of supply chain, slightly reduced demand and all of that, but it's all manageable, right? So, so I don't see job cuts. And I think as we go forward and as markets open and as distribution expands, and as companies think through what new categories will sort of become relevant in the post-COVID world, I also believe, I think this will be sort of a next set of job creation opportunities, right? So in many categories, I think we were talking about sanitizers, on how demand for sanitizers has gone like 10x in the short term. Even if it comes back to like a lower level, it will probably settle down at 2x, 3x, right? So, and that incremental demand has to be sort of manufactured, that incremental demand has to be supplied. I think the second part, at the back end, there will be a lot more job creation, right? So I think buying from the farm, getting a lot more backward integrated to be able to like get high quality raw materials and get raw materials at the price where sort of you can offer value to the consumers. That will also sort of become, that part of the chain will become a bit more organized. And that's, I think, also what will lead to a lot more job creation. I think having said all of this, I think this is still early days in terms of our COVID journey. I think cases are still not coming down. And therefore, I think it's too premature to say when this sort of job creation boost will come in, right? So I think next 2-3 months will make the picture a lot more clearer. Just come out of lockdown and all the positive signs we are seeing in demand, etc., are only like for the last 2-3 weeks, right? So, and therefore, we have to give it like a couple of months to be able to sustain before like companies can take any longer term decisions on hiring and opening up new categories like that.
Okay, so you talked about that the fear has a little bit subsided, but Corona has increased in the past 2 months. And rightly talked about, because we would be definitely seeing a lot of employment in this areas, a lot of opportunities. You rightly talked about that there will be something new, things will also come up in this particular segment, and we will see the different way of doing businesses or in terms of stores and other things. So these were very profound perspectives. So my last curiosity, always, you know, when we talk about with our guests, with industry experts, it is always personal in nature, and we have it with us. So if I talk of you know, Sohail, you know, we know you love traveling and you have traveled far and wide. So if I call you an adventure explorer, okay, how is that significant in shaping you as a leader?
I think that's a very nice question. I've like thought about it a
fair bit. This was not discussed with you.
No, of course not. So you caught me slightly off guard. But I think it's an important question. I think your life experiences shape a lot of what you are, right? So they define you as what sort of a leader you become. I think at least a couple of things which I take from my travels. I think one is, I think there are two big learnings for me. One is like people in general are nice, right? People in general are smart, hardworking, well-meaning. And therefore, if you sort of let them be as individuals and give them independence and give them empowerment or ask for their help, they sort of do very, very well, right? So I think that sort of made me and I think different exposures, different cultures, many places where I don't know language in a country I'm traveling to, that sort of made me a bit more trusting of people, right? So I think, and that's sort of reflective in my, hopefully in my leadership style. I think it's unfair to ask this question to me. You should ask this to some people who work with me. But I think that's one. And I think the second is sort of, I've sort of become a bit more comfortable with ambiguity and a bit more sort of risk-taking in nature. And again, risk-taking is a wrong word, but more like what can possibly go wrong, right? What is the worst which can happen out of this situation? And sometimes when you think like that, you put things into perspective, right? If the worst which can happen is like a couple of crore of loss, or if the worst which can happen out of this is like maybe you have to do like redo something which you've done for 2 weeks, that's not such a bad outcome. That's not a life-shaping outcome, right? And therefore, it sort of makes you much more comfortable with the ambiguity, with the risk, and therefore sort of makes you a lot more forward-looking, right? So, and hopefully, I think hopefully this sort of travel and ability to see different parts of the world, ability to, or to be put in strange situations and sort of emerge out of them unscratched, has sort of given me a bit more perspective on looking at opportunities on what can be the worst case outcome. And if that worst case is not bad enough, then you've sort of nothing to worry.
Yeah, I mean, that in fact, the two things which you talked about is reflective in your personality as well. One is, probably trusting people, believing in people, that is there in your personality. And the choice of places which you visit, which you have in your, maybe in your diary to travel, is generally people travel to Europe and you travel to Peru, so a lot of different things are there. So, and that's,
I have no concerns against Europe, but I think I can do Europe when I'm 60 years old, so might as well do the tougher part of the world right now.
Okay, so here was the views of Mr. Sohail Sami, who is very confident about growth of FMCG sector, huge opportunities in way, and it's always a delight speaking to you, Sohail. Thank you so much for being with us in our growth series.
My pleasure. Thank you, Pankaj. Take care.
Thank you. Thanks, Sohail.